Boom, what's up everyone? Welcome to Simulation. I'm your host, Alan Sakyan. We are still on site at COFES, the Congress on the Future of Engineering Software, for our second annual partnership with them. We are now speaking to Hans Hartmann. Hello.
Hi, how are you?
Thanks for coming on to the show.
All right,
really
pleasure.
Appreciate it. I'm very excited to be talking about all things photography, video, collaboration, innovation in this space, and the future of it. It was really cool when I learned about Hans. Hans has spent the last 7.5 years as the president of Suite 48 Analytics, doing user and market research practice for photo and video industry. Also 6.5 years as the chair of Visual First, which is conference promoting innovation and partnership in photo and video ecosystem. And I also was first, when I approached Hans, was just like, why hasn't there been a conference in the photo and video space yet? There's so much innovation and collaboration to come that can come from that. So.
Right.
I'm very glad that you've been producing this. We're going to explain that, links in the bio, and we're going to end up getting to that in a little bit. First, Hans, we need to talk about your journey. How did you even get interested in photography and video in the first place?
Right. So throughout my career, I've either been involved in electronic publishing or photography. And I guess the very first job was for a Photoshop plugin startup developer way back. So we added sort of painterly creative effects to Photoshop images. Interesting enough, I mean, that was already artificial intelligence before it was even called like that. So we called it neural brushes. So you had a very painterly artistic effect that you could apply to your photos.
What year was this?
This was early 90s.
Okay.
So that far,
cool.
Far ago. And then I worked for a company called Live Picture, which was an early Photoshop competitor. The CEO at the time was John Sculley after he left Apple. And we did quite a bit of innovations on competing with a Photoshop, primarily how to work with very, very large images. In many ways, what you see in Lightroom, non-destructive editing, that kind of stuff, you could already do there. We introduced the concept of layers.
Oh yeah, oh my gosh, layers was such a good, important advancement in the field, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, can you imagine without, you know, a world without layers in editing program? So anyway, so I've worked off and on for software companies, went back into electronic publishing, and then, say, 7 years ago, I started this research company. And that was just when smartphone photography became real. So around the time you had the iPhone 4, which was just about the right quality of camera that people felt, hey, you know what, if I take a photo with my iPhone, it's actually worth sharing. Mm-hmm. In particular, initially, you know, the photos were so-so, but then they used a filter app like Hipstamatic was a very first one, and then very soon after that, Instagram. So you did like a pastel kind of tint to your images, and they looked like artwork, and they were worth sharing. And of course, the iPhone and then later the Android phones became better in their photo capture capabilities, the filters were less essential in order to make it worth sharing. But so around that time, there was a lot of disruption, and that has, you know, in the sort of the mobile photography. And that has been going on and is in different versions still going on. It's really disrupting how people take photos, how they share photos, how they enhance the photos, how they create products, you know, photo products, and order that from your phone. So there's a lot of disruption going on and it has been going on in a very short time frame.
Yes, I want to ask you a bunch of different things. One of the things that I want to ask you is that it was so interesting learning about photography being 200 years old, and when first looking at these photographs that were taken, just the crazy amount of work that had to go into even just one photograph being captured, and now the digital photos that we take everywhere all the time and that they're stored. And like you said, now they have to be enhanced less because as the exponential technology has gotten better and cheaper, the lenses have gotten better, the processing has gotten better. And so now the photos are more easily able to be uploaded. And like you were explaining with the software, all of the different techniques and strategies. Tell us about this kind of like this big history perspective on how you've seen, you know, the last 30 years, you were kind of indicating it, but really, give us that long perspective.
Okay. Yeah, depending how old the audience is and how long they've been following this. But you know, if you are relatively new, if you've been born and raised in the digital era, it's almost hard to imagine how film photography worked. And the most important thing there is, you know, after you took a photo with a film camera, you couldn't view your photo. So you had to buy, well, yeah, first of all, you should have bought film to begin with, otherwise it wasn't a photo, but you needed a film developed, then you need to be printed, and only then did you see how that photo turned out. And that was obviously a cash cow for companies like Kodak and Agfa. So in those days, people were very selective in when to take a photo, because every photo you took cost money. Now it's free, and basically hard disk space is almost free. Cloud storage free space is so cheap, it's almost virtually free. So we're living now in an era of abundance and abundance photography, which is fascinating, that whole change. I think another thing, but that's more from an industry perspective, that's interesting in that longer view of where things came from and where they're heading, is that sort of before 1990, all the innovations in the world of photography were done by imaging vendors themselves. So they invented, you know, the basically film. Then you got flexible film, 35mm. Then at some point you could shoot in color. There were very popular cameras like the Hipstamatic or the Instamatic from Kodak. Mm-hmm. But all these inventions and all these changes that they accomplished came from within the imaging industry. And around 1990, and that's sort of when I start doodling in this space, the imaging industry adapted and was changed rather quickly, and a lot of disruption going on, but the innovations came from outside the imaging industry. So it was no longer the Kodaks and the Agfas and the Canons or the Nikons that changed things. They adapted to changes outside the industry. And the very first one was basically a program like Photoshop coming to the world. So suddenly you could enhance these digital photos in many ways. And what was even more important with Photoshop is you could also do your color separations. So if you wanted to go to a real print job, not a digital print, but the CMYK print, you could separate your colors in a program like Photoshop. So there was a beginning of the desktop revolution, mm-hmm. but that had a tremendous impact on the imaging industry. So that was one major change. Then you had other various changes over time. We already mentioned the smartphone, mm-hmm. which is just unbelievably has been unbelievably destructive or disruptive disruptive and disruptive, I would say,
and democratizing
everybody could afford having a camera, and everybody actually has a camera in their pocket at all times. That's almost as fundamental change as what I said earlier. You no longer had to pay for every photo you take, and you can immediately see it, having a camera in your pocket, no matter where you are, what kind of gathering, at least in the Western world and big chunks of the non-Western world, almost everybody has a camera in their pocket. And hence, people take photos like, you know, there's no tomorrow in that sense.
Yeah.
So that was a change. The smartphone the phone industry basically made changes. Then you've seen things like AI that also came outside of the imaging industry, mostly in the academic world. And now suddenly, you know, even though you might take thousands and thousands of photos, you have AI to auto-classify or auto-tag images, so you find the right images through a click of a button, so to say. AI is being used for very smart photo enhancement, so even if you don't quite know how to put the settings in or how to change things in Photoshop. So there are quite a few very innovative applications out there based on AI. It's just a click of a button and you have a beautiful photo. So there's a lot of changes, a lot of disruption. The internet, it also seems like a token, but the fact that you can share your photo with the entire world and that all the major communication networks, I mean the Facebooks, the Instagrams of the world, the Twitter, all of them have a lot of photo tools built in. And again, that was also a change that was not in the imaging industry, but has had a big impact on the imaging industry. So lots of things have happened and are still happening.
Yes.
In particular, I mean, here at the conference, or the speech I will be holding later, the three areas I want to zoom in on is this AI in many different, you know, use cases. AR, mm-hmm. So that's also a very fundamental crazy thing, that the smartphone camera is now becoming the most important AR viewing device.
Yeah.
I mean, initially people, when AR came out, said, well, you know, it's going to be goggles and that's all too cumbersome. Now it's, you know, you pick up your smartphone, you look at something, you get shopping information, or you can visualize what a chair, an IKEA chair, will look in your own living room if you just look at your living room like that. Mm. So that's yet a thing that's really at the beginning of a lot of change, that these smartphones are becoming the viewing device for AR. And then the very latest that I'm very fascinated by is, as recent as, what is it, 4 or 5 weeks ago at Mobile World Congress in Barcelona, suddenly were 3-4 very high-end smartphones with really beautiful cameras, expensive also, but they all now have also a time-of-flight depth sensor in the back of the cameras. And we already know it a little bit with the iPhone X and XS, where they also have a depth sensor on the front of the camera, so you can have really fancy, you know, nice looking AR effects on your face. Now you get all these high-end cameras and they can measure the depth and then the placement of any sort of artificial object in your environment, that you, the real environment that you're viewing through your phone, is very, very precise. So AR will get a tremendous bump once these high-end smartphones are actually coming to market.
Yeah, the history you just walked us through, so cool. Going from not being able to see the photo after you first stake it and having to go get it developed, all the way to Kodak collapsing because it's not unable to innovate. And there's so many reasons now that there are these R&D departments at the company so they can stay innovative rather than fall. And then all the way to the democratization of the photos, and now the application of artificial intelligence, augmented reality, depth sensing is so fascinating. One of the things that is starting to maybe make more sense to me now is that when biology developed vision capabilities, it was a massive evolutionary step.
Right.
And then when we then developed a second vision capability that was so democratized, our ability to just take photos and store that for free, basically, video store that for free, basically, that is now just very recent in our ability to capture every single moment like that. And now we're adding these cameras to robots and to all of the automation technologies and AI that exists, and the sensors on all the Internet of Things era. And so now the cameras have gotten so good with the depth sensing and everything, and we're slapping them on top of all of the robots.
Yeah.
So this is it's a revolution in perception for the digital, the digital space as well.
And that last element of we call it internally, we call it heuristic imaging. So the fact that if a camera or a system understands what's in that image, you can build certain rules to immediately act upon, instead of it going to a human and says, okay, somebody who looks like grandma is crossing the street in my car, I better slow down. That kind of heuristic algorithms can be made as self-driving cars, but there's a lot of AI-based visual implementations in robotic engineering, etc. You have all these sensors, and you have computing, I mean, that's the other element to it. It's not just that the cameras are getting better, but you have the cameras are in a device that is so computing-wise so powerful. I mean, it's the same as most computers were 2, 3, 4 years ago, if not better already. So these are power beasts in terms of being able to compute all kind of things and apply algorithms and even learn on the fly. So everything is happening in real time now, because that device can handle that, and it can talk to Internet of Things kind of devices. So whatever, you know, you see somebody in front of your house, or the camera, the camera sees something in front of your eyes and sends you a text, like, it seems like grandma's coming by, or whatever.
Yes.
I mean, there's so much you can do.
Yeah, the application of both image and video classifying for the purposes of doing things as simple as just like Google Images and being able to just click on an image on a person's face. This is probably a good time to then ask you about Suite 48.
Yeah.
Because now it's been 7.5 years of you building this out and doing all of the video and photo research on industry analytics. So teach us about what that's been like.
Yeah. Yeah, what's interesting, so we have an annual conference, and until last year we called it Mobile Photo Connect. It's a mouthful, but you know, we were a startup and we didn't want to build our own brand. So we said, well, why don't we describe in the name of the conference what this is all about? So we had the word mobile in there, and we had the word photo in there. And connect, I think that's still an applicable term, but both other terms, mobile and photo, you know, we as an industry have already moved beyond that. So mobile, it's almost no matter what you do, mobile is part of anything. Like in the first internet era, people call themselves, oh, we are an internet company. Well, everybody should be at least an internet company, otherwise they're probably out of business. So everybody has an internet strategy, and that's the same with mobile now. So the word mobile we took out of the name of the conference. And then the second thing was photos. Which is also interesting, because you don't have just photos. Obviously, video, and video is growing pretty rapidly, also being made easier, in particular with the video editing and being able to handle large files and blah, blah, blah. So video is important. But then you have this whole range of what we called FODIO, P-H-O-D-O, sort of a in between photos and videos. I mean, you have the Instagram GIFs, boomerang, animated GIFs. I mean, you name it. There are a lot of formats that are in between, because that seems to be something that really attracts at least certain segments and certain demographics. That needs to be super short, needs to be a little bit cooler than just a photo. So there's all FODIOs. So anyway, so we got rid of the term mobile, we got rid of the term photo, because photo was too limited, mobile was a given, and now the conference is called Visual First, which goes back into the philosophy that so much communication now, even you know, in a Twitter or a WhatsApp, in messaging apps or in an Instagram, the communication starts with a visual. And that's why all these social networks and messaging apps have a big camera button right there, so you, instead of you send a text and say, oh, by the way, why don't you illustrate it with a photo and add a photo to it, which you can still do, and that, but that was sort of in the past how people do it. Now often communication starts with a photo or a video.
The bandwidth,
you might add
higher.
A text to it. Yeah,
I can send you a quick 10-second video through the message platform, and you can get a significantly more data from that of how I feel emotionally through my face, facial expressions.
Yeah, you have sound, so you can have a voice or whatever, you know, music that, you know, illustrates your point better. So you know, in an era where everybody's bombarded with text and information, having something that is by its nature visual, and even visual with movements or with sound, that a lot of people gravitate towards that kind of communication. So it's really a visual first era that we're moving in now that the phones are better and the connections are better. And 5G is around the corner, and then it's like completely instantaneous, whatever you want to share.
Correct. Yeah. Whoa. Yeah. Yes, I like the transition to visual first is that's good, because you're right that even the show, for example, is is through video format as well as through audio format for those that are just listening. And not only that way are we going across more platforms and impacting, potentially inspiring more people, but at the same time, those that want the sound along with the visual, the emotional cues, all that kind of stuff can get it through that way. So you have the visual first. Then, you know, then what does it look like? Do Hans and Alan turn into three-dimensional holograms within the augmented reality sphere? Is that like a next visual second? Is that the next?
I think, you know, we talk about a bunch of really disruptive, very drastic changes already. I think this whole notion that very soon, no matter what you look at around you, you could have, it's almost like you have a website that flows along with what you're seeing. So you have extra information. I might look at you, and I know that often with technology innovations, the first generation isn't quite right, and people say, no, it's never going to work, like Google Glasses. I'm thinking cooler, easier, less disruptive in the sense of, you know, distracting to people. But if I can look at you, I've never met you before, and somewhere in the corner of my eye I can see you, you know, there's a face identification, look it up on LinkedIn, I met you at some conference, I forgot when and where, and immediately I'm just looking at you, this conference at this date, the guy.
Correct.
Or he's looking for a job, that's what LinkedIn information.
Yes.
So the fact that you can sort of look around you and there is this extra layer of information or, you know, could also be fun, boring, could be creative, not necessarily I want to learn, but can enjoy myself. I think AR, it's still going to struggle around the form factor.
Yeah.
Holding ad hoc a smartphone, that's not ideal, and certainly it's not. I mean, you still have to hold it. You cannot drive at the same time.
Glasses but are still a little strange.
Yeah, the goggles in particular are still, that's really a big step because you're really sort of removing yourself.
Contact lenses are potential.
There could be one. There's a company called Wayray that does very interesting thing by being able to project it on cars' window screens. And then the driver will see some information of what is in front of the car, warnings if a car is too close to them. Right. And then the passenger may actually see some other stuff, like, hey, what to do, where to shop.
Museums over here.
You don't want to distract the driver from that stuff. So
so
using screens, I think screens are sort of an underused way of doing AR. But there's a lot of startups and established companies who are trying to figure out what is the right device. But as innovation often goes, it's not quite perfect, and it's sort of a lame first attempt. People say it's not perfect, but it's good enough, right? Maybe you also had it. I've had some discussions, in particular with my colleagues from Germany in the past, when MP3 came out as a audio file for war, there is compression in it. I'm not going to use that. I can hear the difference. Whether they really could hear it, I doubt it. But you know, often good enough goes a long way.
Low goes a long way.
If it's easy, if it's cheap,
if it can get to 8 billion people
So you know, smartphone AR, I think, has definitely a future. But you know, having something in the window of your house, and you look outside to your yard, and you see a bird, and it immediately says what bird it is, or whatever. You know,
there's
you don't even have to hold something in front of you.
Correct. That's a big part of the future, is making the most frictionless ways to get the information, and the least clunky ways, the most beautiful ways. These are very important pillars of the way we design our future technology.
Right.
Hans, I want to ask you, this our sort of trek with memetics, with memes, it used to be a very, very hard thing to get a letter across the country.
Uh-huh.
And then it became, okay, it's not so hard, you can send an email across the country. And now it's the person that has the millions and millions of followers or subscribers or whatever can launch off these messages to millions of people around the world in just a flash. Yeah. So that sort of memetic dissemination trajectory, teach us about the importance of that in this, in the visual first realm.
Yeah. Well, ultimately, you know, it's about the content. So what is that person trying to convey? But given that, if a message is visual, it applies to how people perceive information. So a visual, first of all, it's better noticed. I mean, advertisers have known that forever, right? But something with visuals in it, photos, and then even more so video, it is being noticed. It's also better remembered than just text-based information. And like I said earlier, we already overloaded with information, so it's better remembered. And there are also statistics that if you get something with a visual in it, you're way more likely to share it on Twitter or other formats. So that's just the nature of and the power of visuals. So that, in combination with somebody having something useful to say, I mean that. That becomes a very powerful and to some extent a viral, could become a viral thing that lots of people pick up on that. But ideally, to be successful as a communicator to a large audience, you need to have elements of all of those. But being visual is almost obligatory, unless you have like a really cute text only. I guess if you're the president of the United States, your tweets are being noticed if it's text only, but everybody else, it better be visual and attractive.
Yeah. It's interesting how much more data can be passed along to others with a video component to it. But you're right, then depending on the level of prominence is also another thing. If you have lots of clout, you can deliver just a text message that gets to lots of people, which is...
Can even have typos in it, and he manages to do that too. It's being noticed.
That is interesting. Now what is with what you're doing with Suite 48 and with Visual First, you know, you've been giving us some of the ways that you've been analyzing, but like what is one's process, like you and your teams, how do you analyze?
Right.
Like especially these new generations, because you know, when you grew up with technology is different than when I grew up with technology, which is different than when a 10-year-old is growing up right now with their technology.
Yeah.
They have never not had technology,
like
the smartphone and the laptops and stuff. So how do you analyze the different visual arts as well as the generations that you
see? It sort of depends what kind of research we are doing. I mean, some research is really focused on particular solution areas or particular markets. And then, like right now, we're doing a big study around the gig photography enablers. What I mean with a gig photographer is somebody who sort of makes a buck on the side because they like taking photos or editing photos. You don't need to be a photographer, but the lot of enabling services now that if you say, like, you're an Uber driver or list as an Uber driver, hey, you know what, I have a couple of hours Thursday afternoon, I'd like to make some extra money, they can be engaged to do a photo shoot somewhere. It could be a school, or it could be whatever, a sports event, or sometimes even like real estate photos. So anyway, that's a study we're doing now, but they're focused not so much on the gig photographer, him or herself. In this case, I just want to have a good understanding of what kind of innovative Uber-like solutions are out now. So that's basically a matter of talking with a lot of vendors in that space and a lot of these service providers and try to understand how they're different, what kind of problems they tackle or not. Mm-hmm. So that's more of a qualitative study.
like literally having a pool of photographers or videographers in a city like San Francisco that are on the platform that get a that potentially get a ping when the little wedding event pops up, and that the ones that are available Tuesday afternoon can go out and and capture
that's an
that.
Example of a service. So in that case, I talk with a service provider. The example comes to mind that you describe as a company called Sweet Escape. Interesting enough, they are based in Indonesia. That's where they started.
Interesting.
They have 2,000 photographers all over the world, also major cities in the US. And that's exactly how it works. Like, I have a birthday event coming up. Actually, that's what the founder said when I interviewed him. The founder said, you know, this, like many startups, right, they first try to solve their own problems. But, you know, he's really a photographer, or has always been a photographer and always into it. But if he goes to, they hold a birthday event, I mean, he's never in the photos himself. So I say, you know, I want to have an easy way for this event that I normally take the photos with. I try to participate and also be in the photos. So he founded this company. But anyway, so going back to your earlier question, how do you research it? In this case, I interview a lot of these service providers or app developers and try to get a good sense of what they're doing and their vision about the market. With other studies, we basically do surveys and get a quantitative idea. We haven't done it yet for gig photographers, but that could be one, and then we have survey questions. Sometimes, you know, the end user research is done through focus groups, which is, you know, a way smaller group of people you interview, but more in depth. So depending a little bit on the topics and the questions we try to get out of it, it's either quantitative to end users or qualitative to the end users. And if it's more the providers, the developers, then it's usually interviewing a lot of people and then get some sense of what's going on.
And then I love the idea of interviewing, obviously.
You're good at it.
Thank you. And I'm sure then you have as well become very good, because when you're trying to go and talk to the different, like the cutting edge of the fields of, like you said, this gig economy around photo and video and doing the interviews, then you're understanding what different niches are being filled across the world in these fields. And then this follow-up question is, when you're looking at all of the data that you've taken in around, okay, they're filling this niche, this one's going really broad, this one's going into a niche, right? So there's sort of these different these different ways of approaching it. What do you do with that analysis? Do you then teach that to industry, to research and development firms?
Most often the direct, well, a couple of things actually, but most often the direct result of doing all that research around a certain question, like in this case, gig photography, most often that results in a research report, and that's what we sell. So that's our way of monetizing knowledge. A lot of other sort of ongoing or ad hoc knowledge about what's going on in the industry goes into our free newsletter, which in the end, you know, it usually leads to something. Either people end up being or buying a report, or they end up attending our conference. But that's more it's a bi-weekly newsletter where we sort of look at different trends in the industry and news there. And then another way that we monetize the knowledge is often that we then have panels around certain topics at our own conference. So we've had really early on, when AI just came out of the academic world and got into image recognition and vision, we had panels. We had a panel very early on with the first image recognition vendors. I know one of them is actually now what is Amazon Recognition. Recognition with a K. So they were acquired by Amazon. So we've covered a lot of topics also and have had panel discussions around topics that we also did research on. So we could, you know, push it a little bigger or a little deeper in our Q&A at the conference.
So people can sign up for the newsletter for free.
Yep.
They can purchase the and the reports that you provide. And then the conference Visual First happens in Oakland?
It's actually in San Francisco.
It is in San Francisco.
In the Presidio.
In the Presidio.
Yeah,
beautiful.
Very nice old offices building. Golden Gate Club.
Presidio is so gorgeous. So annual, right?
Yeah,
annual.
It's October 3rd and 4th this
October
year.
3rd and 4th, okay. All right. And then now... Okay, give us these themes. When you're putting together I'm interested to see if these are similar. When you're putting together the reports and when you're putting together the panels at
right.
Visual First, are these similar themes? Like you said, the gig photography, like what are some of the themes?
Yeah, some of them are. So with gig photography, because that's a big study right now, I'm almost sure we'll have a panel around that. And other panels we haven't done specific in-depth research on, but we know it's on everybody's mind in the sort of in that ecosystem of, you know, imaging vendors. Like for instance, you know, a topic, because quite a few of the imaging vendors are in the photo print space, Snapfish or Shutterfly, these kind of guys. Often there is a topic around, you know, how can you monetize photo engagement by, you know, adding a print button in an app that might not have been on people's, you know, minds, like, hey, I'm going into the app to order a print, but if it's an easy sort of suggestion, why don't you order, you know, a wall decor product for of that photo? So that's a topic.
If the user experience was a little bit more frictionless, that if there was a prediction of, oh, this is maybe the first time you've taken this photo with your family in this beautiful area of a new place,
yeah,
maybe you want to order one for
exactly.
the home in a print.
Exactly. Yeah. And that requires quite a bit of, you know, education also to an industry that has always done it in certain ways, and in certain ways they're still doing it similar to before the smartphone era. Like, hey, collect all your photos, come to my app, download an app.
Yeah,
so you're already
yeah.
committed to doing something.
Yeah.
And the problem with that for these vendors is if people are really saying, okay, I want a photo book of 32 pages, if you then sort of come into the picture as a vendor, then people start doing price comparisons also. And in that particular part of the photo industry, there's a lot of discounting and order now. And so then you're in an, you know, in a competitive bidding thing, and
definitely.
Prices go down. But you know, like one of the companies that have also showed this solution at our conference, they built a solution that, hey, you know what, in January, if you want to have all your photos that you have shared on Facebook in a photo book, literally you do it on your smartphone, it's a click, 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 and you have a whole photo book
wow.
laid out.
Yeah.
All the duplicates are automatically removed. So if you market that on Facebook, people are not, because it's a pretty unique solution,
yeah.
maybe there's one, two other ones out in the world, they're not going to do price shopping. Right, so they say, okay, well, cool, then I have my whole life mm-hmm. in a book who care about that.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised how many still care about it and are willing to pay money for.
And other ones, other fields, yeah, panel ideas, these types of areas.
Yeah, and it's a good question. So sometimes it's the direct result of research, and certainly I or my partner have, you know, we have a lot of ideas about, you know, based on that research, what should be done or should not be done. Other things are sort of emerging, and then it's actually also interesting to put a panel together. So right now, I'm very intrigued by these latest smartphones that have depth sensors
yes.
on the back.
Companies like Niantic have both the Pokemon Go and
sure, they can have a way better AR experience.
Yeah.
Maybe it has particular implications for shopping. I don't know yet. So that's interesting maybe have a couple of camera vendors and a couple of app developers. Like, are you really going to use these depth sensors now or not? Because that's actually not that quite clear. I've spoken with enough developers, like, ooh, you know, what's that going to be? But potentially, if it is as impactful as the iPhone X was with the front-facing depth sensor,
mm-hmm.
it could, you know, it could be very interesting. So
more easily having guided people to maybe where you need to be in the museum or in the grocery store with the depth sensing.
Yeah, or like the IKEA app, I put my furniture here, but it's really precisely located instead of, you know, it's sometimes it's really almost an unrealistic object. It cannot quite be in the plant box, but it needs to be in front of the plant box.
Yes.
If you have a depth sensor, you avoid kind of artifacts. So that's at the minimum what I can imagine, but I bet you there are a lot of innovative app developers who are thinking this through now. And also on the camera side, the biggest ones with depth sensors are Samsung and Huawei.
Okay.
And I've already had some conversation with them, and you know, it's all not that crystal clear. So that's an interesting panel to see what the impact will be.
And
having those people and have a conversation in the audience about that topic.
Yes. What is this next? You know, if we ended up doing this transition from in many ways a photography to a videography, does it seem like it's going towards a sort of an augmented depth reality of sorts, that's kind of the next? And I hope that there's a lot of I hope that we do things like guide young people and adults towards like knowledge, right? I hope we guide people towards science, and we, you know, guide people towards world peace, right? These types of things, and not towards conspicuous consumption and all these other kind of crappy things that are in many ways just ruining a human experience. So tell us about what you think that I said.
And people start eating organic and all that stuff. Well, that's a very difficult question. I mean any technology can be used in many different ways, and almost any technology can be used for the better or the worse. As you know, with AI, you know, initially AI in general, not necessarily in the imaging world, but you know, AI can solve really world problems in a big way and make whatever. I mean, you talk about the environment; it can use resources way smarter. And all of that is all good. But there are also discussions with particularly the big five tech companies, where employees are actually writing to their CEO, hey, you know, it's now used by the Department of Defense, or it's going to be used in missiles. And, you know, that's all very hard to tell beforehand. And that's almost with any, you know, face recognition is great because I can take better photos because the camera understands there's a photo in it and automatically applies certain settings. Face recognition can also be used in cameras that the government or a government, in particular China, I hear a lot about.
Correct.
And you're being recorded all the time, and every step is in a government database, and that, you know, but it has always been like that, right? I mean, all innovations, even before digital and before computing, it could go in different ways. So I think, yeah, the best you can do is be alert about certain, you know, ways that people are using the technologies. Unfortunately, I think once a technology has really been invented, the genie doesn't go back in the bottle. I mean, that's I think that's not going to help, and that's not going to work either. So you need to think more about, who do you sell this to, and who are you not willing to sell this to, or regulations. I think what Silicon Valley more recently around AI has learned, that and privacy and security, all these debates, is Silicon Valley in a way has been a little arrogant in thinking, oh, we can self-regulate ourselves, but we're all driven by greed and making money, so that's not going to work either.
Yeah.
But then you need to have a government who actually cares about the right issues, who then would regulate instead. So
the ethical evolving of humanity to the point where it becomes easier to deal with some of the pressing challenges that we're facing is something that we frequently discuss on the show. I want your perspective on a crazy industry, deep fakes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Yeah.
So what do you see? What do we think is best to do when it's indistinguishable if the president of a country actually sent out that video or not, or if it's completely digitally synthesized?
There are even images that are completely artificial and they look like a regular, there was some, I forgot which university, they did a research project on that. Well, that's actually, you asked earlier what are potential topics at a conference if it's not clearly based on a research project. That's another topic I'm toyed to really have there. Like,
we have some interesting people to potentially recommend to you.
I'd love to hear about it. Yeah. I don't know. It will be a combination of incentive. I think the trick is probably to incentivize developers or technology companies to tackle that problem, because it's not obvious that's a problem they can make money from. And unfortunately, that seems how it works. People go, they develop technologies because they think there's a market for it. Very few just choose the topic and the problem out of the goodness of their heart. So, but if there is some setting that it really makes sense for them to identify deepfakes, I wouldn't be surprised that there are ways of really tackling it. I do know that blockchain is actually interesting as a solution for when one photo is identified, player A sells to player B, that can be totally verified that there was no middleman and nothing has changed. But the problem is more that photo A and the owner of that, is that, was that already a good photo or the original photo to begin with or not? So blockchain could be part of the solution, but there could be other AI-based solutions all the way at the beginning that you do some kind of pixel analysis and say this has to be an artificially altered photo. I don't know.
Or maybe it may only have to be trusted if it comes from the source, from the person's account. So nobody could post some video of Hans. Only you could post videos yourself, and that would be the only trusted.
Yeah, and that's relatively easy. Nothing is easy, but I think if it comes from a trusted source, then I think blockchain has a lot of potential. To authenticate the origin of the photo and make sure that in that transaction nothing weird is going on there.
Yeah.
And we are really at the beginning of using blockchain in the imaging industry. So that's another potentially disruptive thing that
can happen. And it's also a great idea to get people paid along the way as you have this decentralized digital ledger, that people can get paid along the way for making the contributions to the to the image or to the video in a very accountable and transparent way. Another thought that I think to ask you about is the future of images and video with drones.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, this is another probably interesting field. We've seen some crazy good drone videography of capturing, rhinos, stampeding through the savannas.
This is the best rhino we've been.
I have to get on all fours to give you the real one.
Go ahead. Was it 2 years ago at our conference? So our conference at that time was at the end of October. We've done a little earlier this year, or we're going to do a little earlier, but that was literally less, maybe 10 days after these enormously destructive fires in the wine country. It was not last year, but the year before. And I don't know if you've seen it, but there was a drone photographer who went there and he shot photos from high above. This was in Santa Rosa, where it was completely destruction, but here and there, there was still a house there. So he shot with his drone that whole moon-like landscape, and then there was a postal worker in his little truck who went then to the very few mailboxes that were still standing, and he was finishing his route. I mean, and the videographer, I mean, he went all over the place in terms of national media, etc. So we were very pleased. It was a local guy. to have him at the conference talk about the power of drone photography or videography in this case. And yeah, it's another fascinating area how visuals, how powerful they can be. I mean, when I saw it the first time, you know, I broke up. I mean, it was so. He also has very, you know, beautiful music around it.
So yes, it's correct.
It's a combination of the visuals and and this poor postal office worker who did something that was totally useless, but that's what he had to do. Anyway, that was a pleasure hearing them from the videography. What motivated him going there? He could have licensed that video to a Getty or one of the stock photo for a lot of money, but he just wanted it out there because he thought it was such a personal story to share. And it was good.
Yeah, that's interesting when the creators can make the decision if they want to publish on their own platforms or license out to others. Then the whole Creative Commons thing is very interesting. Our videos are Creative Commons, so people can take the videos and do talks over them or repurpose them on their channels. The whole purpose is for the content to get out as far as possible for educational purposes, to not be paywalled. So then another thought around this same field a little bit is the importance of the kind of like the global spiritual awakening that we feel when we see photos of Earth from space, from the ISS, from satellites. We can map certain parts of the Earth and see things like deforestation patterns or all different types of Pacific garbage patches or whatever it may be that we're viewing, or resource extractions. There's so many ways of doing this. What have you seen in the satellite photography or videography?
To be honest, I mean, it's not an area I'm following.
Gotcha.
I was going to say it's too far from my home, but it literally is. It's too high in the sky. And partially because, you know, the way we, you know, the market is already pretty big as it is, and we are ultimately more focused on consumer photo and video use. Even drone use, actually the biggest drone use is commercial and agriculture and
still commercial.
And I sort of know about it, but I'm not following that closely because you can only follow so much.
you're on the object that 4 billion people have in their pockets.
That's enough.
So this is interesting. As you know, 8 billion people get the devices, then it's a whole, you know, new conversation on the global consciousness, and then where it goes with maybe a couple billion people getting that augmented reality, whatever it ends up, you know, going to next. Any last thoughts about, you know, about the industry, about you know, maybe some of the things that you can explain to us a little bit that we didn't get to touch on in this last part would be just on the software side of things, how interesting it is to have seen something like Layers first enter into the scene, and now we have, you know, the premiere and the final cuts, and we have the really strong Lightrooms and Photoshops that are sketches that are really able to, you know, to get these gorgeous videos and images out there. So, you know, maybe tell us a bit on the software side as well.
Yeah. Well, I can think of many things that might be of interest, but you know, at the beginning of this interview, we talked about the second job that I had in the U.S. was then with Live Picture, and I talked about Layers, but I think what they did first, and I really sort of a theme that is through my thinking about visuals in general, is the fact that you could make changes to the photo, and they were stored as algorithms. So they were not applied yet to the pixels, so you could work with very, very large files, and then in the end you could say, okay, now render it at this resolution or that resolution. So the idea of doing things with photos or videos that can still be applied to many different kind of outputs, formats or forms. So keep all your options open while you're working on things. I like that a lot. It could end up being, you know, only used at a small resolution on a smartphone or a big screen. Talk about, you know, what's next there also. The 8K video is around the corner. Yeah. So you better start shooting at a resolution that, once that really takes off, it can be also displayed on that 8K video. It is like gigantic in terms of, you know, the sizes of the files that are implied. Yeah. Yeah. So that's, I guess that's one concept of what I've always found pretty important. I think the other thing about this whole industry is it's so interesting to see. I mean, I sometimes work with startups, like two guys in the Ukraine have a crazy idea, brilliant engineers, and they come out with an app, and some of them have done amazingly well, and then they are struggling and talking and thinking about technology, similar to somebody who's part of the Canon or the Nikon or the, mm-hmm. the Fujifilm, you know, corporation. So you see a lot of, because a lot of barriers to entry to become a developer, and there's so much you know, source codes available, the computing power is in the sky, basically. Everybody uses AWS. Correct. Or something. Yes. Similar to. Yes. That. So you can, as a startup, you can be very powerful if you come up with the right idea and the right implementation at the right time, which is all very hard to do. Correct. It all three. Yes, of. Yes, that. Yes, but yes. You know, small companies have been amazingly successful, and some of them have done also well. I mean, probably our biggest success story, I mean, I mentioned earlier that a company called Orbeez that was then acquired by Amazon, but we also had a company, I liked them a lot, and they were actually from the Ukraine. They were a little bigger, maybe 20 or 30 people at that time, but they were the ones, the first ones that if you have, you take a selfie, you know, you can have crazy real-time effects in the video, like steam is coming out of your ears or something like that.
Yes.
So they showed it to us. In our conference in October, they were still in beta, and then in June, Snapchat had bought them for $150 million.
Oh,
and that's
goodness.
Really what Snapchat Lenses was.
Yeah.
And Snapchat did really, really well. For the longest time, the only way that Snapchat was monetizing itself earlier on was through these sponsored lenses, as they call them.
Mm-hmm.
Now they have advertising in, you know, other areas of their app.
Yeah.
So they actually made that money back, seemingly quite fast.
Yes.
Anyway, I like working with startups and developers who have crazy ideas, and this was a thing that just came out at the right time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then Facebook had to scramble, and they bought another company for also a lot of money that did something similar to that, because everybody felt these were in essence AR effects.
Correct. AR effects.
Real-time AR effects.
Real-time AR effects.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
I like that.
Yeah. Can't. It's crazy how you can't let your competitors get the next edge thing that all the people want to use without you getting and developing it yourself to stay up to pace. Maybe we need to ask you this as well at the end, just this idea of a, you know, on a geopolitical scale, do you see any visual, you know, the big visual differences across countries? You gave that example of the company in Indonesia.
Yeah.
But it's always seemed like Japan is always at, you know, the cutting edge of technology and stuff.
It used to be.
teach us about this.
Yeah, no, I think Japan has been associated with the traditional digital cameras, you know, Canon and Nikon, Fujifilm is also headquartered in, and these companies in the DSLR, mirrorless, high-end camera space have, you know, they've struggled to keep being relevant. So I definitely don't think Japan is the powerhouse anymore as it used to be. China, actually, if you talk about it sort of depends a little bit what area of imaging you're looking at. But if you talk about cameras, there's a lot of things happening in China with more the cheaper cameras, surveillance, 360. A lot of 360 vendors, including Insta360, which is sort of the largest now of with their cameras.
Wow.
in areas of image recognition, I would say it's Israel and Russia, Ukraine. A lot of companies came from there or are based there. So it varies a little bit per application area, but I think in general, going back to the Japan question, I mean, I think the high-end traditional digital cameras are still doing quite well there because there's a culture that quality matters more than price, and even if quality means that there's a fair amount of learning and manual action required, I mean, people still do that, and that's a little harder here. It depends. I mean, on the other end of Fujifilm, they came out with something that has been a tremendous success, first in Japan, particularly among teenagers, what they call their Instax cameras. So they are like the old Polaroid cameras in many ways, but it could also be digital. And basically, you take a photo and immediately you print in real time. And lo and behold, the people who do that are kids and teenagers because they want to hand a physical print to somebody else. And like, all teenagers, if you have kids or grandchildren or whatever, people hang photos on the walls.
Yes.
But that was actually, if I would have, that's why I need to be, I need to be very careful putting cliches on, well, these countries develop more these things.
Sure.
I would not have thought that a Japanese camera company would come up with something that is cool and retro and is a runaway success with teenagers. I would have never thought so.
Yeah.
And they are runaway success because the Instax printers from Fuji, that they by themselves sell about the same number of units as all mirrorless or interchangeable cameras, meaning the mirrorless and DSLRs.
Yeah.
And they sell more than all, from all vendors, all point-and-shoot cameras combined. Wow. So that was a tremendous success.
Who would have thought that retro would come back like that? Yeah.
And I think internally they didn't.
That's so interesting.
They didn't think it would be that big of a success either.
And you pointed out,
so you need to be careful with labeling,
Correct. And you still pointed out Israel's at its own edge, Russia is in some ways, in Ukraine, that there's different pockets of visual technology edges that are across the world. Okay, great. This has been super fun and super enlightening.
Likewise, also on my end. Yeah.
I'm really happy to hear that. Yeah, thank you for coming on to the show.
All right,
really appreciate you a lot. Thank you so much.
All right.
We greatly appreciate you all for tuning in. Thank you so much. We would love to hear your thoughts in the comments below. Everyone, let us know your thoughts in the comments below. Also, let us know about what your thoughts are in terms of just sharing the message around the community, around the world, get more people talking about what it's like on the camera, photography, video, ages, all the things that we discussed. Check out the links below to Hans's work. Also check out the links below to Kofez, and support the artists and entrepreneurs that you believe in. Everyone, support Simulation below as well. And go and build the future, everyone. Manifest your dreams into the world. Thanks for tuning in, and we will see you soon.
Peace.